So what we were discussing basically in the last week, we were discussing some mechanisms for virtualizing the memory for supporting our virtual address space. And we discussed the base and bound approach and the segmentation approach. So the last class we discussed the segmentation approach. So in the segmentation approach, what we were doing basically that we were instead of allocating the entire virtual address space, the memory in the physical memory, we were basically dividing our virtual address space into different logical segments, maybe code, heap and stack. And each segment we were independently relocating in the physical memory. And to keep track of the location of each segment, we needed multiple base and bound registers for each segment. So that gave more flexibility. Advantage was we got more flexibility. We avoided the wastage of free space. We could allocate. Now we could support a large virtual address space, which could be sparse. That means there can be a lot of free space between heap and stack. But still, we will not end up allocating that free space a real physical memory. We'll be only allocating space to the actual segments which are actually being used. So that was the basically advantage. And we could share also different segments can be shared using the protection bits. So there can be support for protection bits for each segments, which can help us to decide whether we want to give read, write, or execute access to each segment. And in that way, we can share our code segment, let us say, because code is generally common for multiple processes. And we discussed this, that OS roles remains the same. It has to still manage the free space. It has to allocate and deallocate spaces. And whenever there's a context switch, it has to save and restore the base and bound values of that process. So all the base and bound values for this entire information needs to be switched, needs to be stored in the PCB, and this information needs to be read from the PCB of the next process into the into the base and bound registers. And it also needs to do defragmentation. We'll talk about that shortly. So we said how address translation would happen in this case. So basically, we took some examples to illustrate. And the way it is implemented in hardware was basically, if let us say if you have a 16 kilobyte address space, virtual address space, then for 16 kilobyte, you need 14 bits. So we decide the number of bits that are there for address space, and we keep the top few bits for the segments and the remaining bits for the offset. So if we have three segments, for example, here, we will need at least 2 bits to denote our segment number. And the remaining bit will be used to identify the offset within that segment. So in this case, if we have, for example, if we have only code, heap and stack, we'll need 3 segments, and if code is the first segment, we can give the 00 will represent for code. If heap is the next segment after code, then 01 will be the segment number for the heap. And in this case, in our example, there was free space between heap and segment. So probably 1 and 0 is a free space, is a free segment. And the stack is the last segment, which will have the number 3. So that is 1, 1. So how the address translation is done basically. Thus, we said basically it will know the segment number. It will go to the segment base value. It will read the base value, base register of that particular segment to get the starting address, and it will basically add the offset to the base address, and then use the bound address value to check whether it is the actual physical address is within the bound of that segment or not. So in that way, it will do the protection thing also. So that was what we discussed in the last class. So an example was here, 4200, for example, the binary representation will be this. So the top, if you see the top two bits, it represents the heap. It represents the heap segment. So within the heap segment, the offset was would be this. So the example was this. So the offset was this, and 34K was the base register value for the heap segment. So if you add these two, you will get the actual physical address of that particular location. So 4200 will be getting mapped to this physical location in our memory. So to make it more clear, let us take some questions, some simple examples. I hope I have a slide here, so I don't have to. So I hope this slide is visible. So I have put some question here. First question basically says, is just a question to think about. In case if you have a small address space, let us say a very small address space, let us say 32 kilobytes or 16 kilobytes, and we don't have enough number, and we have more number of segments. So let us say we don't have enough number of bits to be used for segment addressing. Then in that case, what could be done? So for example, here we were wasting one. We had only three segments, code, heap, and thing. But we were using actually two bits, which was more than what was needed. So we were basically kind of not proper, fully optimized using it was not an optimal usage of our bit addressing. So we were using more bits than that was required. So if you want to avoid that, let us say, is there a way hardware can manage without that? Can hardware know in something about the segment, which segment a particular address belongs to, without explicitly looking into these segment bits? So in the book, this question is there in the book. So I just brought it from there. So they say basically there is some way. If, for example, if you have only, if you have divided our address space as into logical segments only, then it can be, hardware can know whether a particular memory reference is coming from the code section or a heap section by looking at the type of the reference. So if it is an instruction fetch, probably it is coming from a code section, or if it is a pointer address, it is coming if it are local variables, then it is coming from stack. If it is a dynamically allocated memory, it is coming from heap. So in that way also, hardware can try to optimize the bit space. But that was just a side point. The question, just I want to make you practice this question here. Before this, let me just talk about one thing more here, just final thing here. So there is coarse grained segmentation and fine grained segmentation. I hope the recording had started. Coarse segmentation versus fine grained segmentation. So when we were dividing our address space into logical segments only, then that is called coarse segmentation. We have only few segments, let us say code, heap, and stack. These are only two or three segments. It is called coarse segmentation. But we can also, there is no hard and fast rule to stick to only these segments, logical segments. We can end up dividing our address space into multiple more number of segments, which is called fine grained segment. So rather than having a two or three logical segments, we can have, let us say, eight segments or more segments. Because what was happening here, if we are restricting ourselves to code, heap, and stack, then we are end up wasting this free this space of this segment as a free segment. So instead of doing that, if we let us just divide, instead of not, we don't give a name to a segment, whether it is a core segment or a heap segment, we just give a segment number. Segment number 0, segment number 1, 2, so on, or maybe more. Then we can give whichever segment to whichever portion of the address space we want. We can give, let us say, two segments, segment number 1 and 2 for heap, and segment number 0 for code, segment number 6 and 5 for stack, and so on. And in that way, we can actually, it can be a little more flexible. So this fine grade segmentation is basically meant for supporting more number of segments. And for this case, to do this, hardware needs to we need hardware support in the form of something called segment table. So because now there are multiple segments, it's better to store all that information in a segment table. So we will have a segment table where we have a segment numbers, then correspondingly we'll have the base register values, bound register values, and protection bit. So instead of having now as base and bound register pairs only, we can have an entire table in the hardware. We can have this entire table in the hardware. So now all the informations can be stored in a table. And then for address translation, the hardware will keep looking, indexing into this segment table to get the relevant information. So this example that I'm showing here in this slide is kind of a segment table. So we are not referring it to whether it is a code, heap, or thing. We are just referring as a segment number. And we have base and bound values for that and the read-write protection bits. And let us say it is a 16, we are using it for a 16-bit virtual address space. So our virtual address space is 16 bits. And we have four segments in it, 1, 0, 1, 2, and 3. So first of all, whenever the question comes like this, a numerical question normally comes like this. First of all, we need to understand how many bits will be used for segments and how many bits will be used for offsets. So a 16-bit address space, how many bits will be divided, will be used for a segment, and how many bits will be used for offset. So if there are four segments, you will need how many bits? We'll need 2 bits for segments, and the remaining, which is 16 minus 2, which is your 14 bits for offset, isn't it? So let us now translate. Let us say the question comes to translate these logical address, which are given in hexadecimal value, using the base and bound values. So can you get the physical addresses for all these? So let us start with this first one. So it is 0240. See, it is in hexadecimal representation. So which of the segment it is referring to? So the top 2 bits. So this address is basically, let me write it here. So 0000, and then it is 20010, and that is 40100, and then it is further 0. So this is the binary representation. So the top 2 bits are your segment number. So it is basically referring to the segment 0. So the base value is this, and the bounds is this. So what will be the physical address for this particular logical address? What will be the actual physical address? So here the bounds are, I think, represents the size of the segment. No, but the size of the segment here is so what convention we were using? Yeah. So the size can be, size of the segment can be of 2 to the power 14. So that's why it is 6FF. Yeah. So it is. Now size of each segment size is of 2 to the power 14 bytes. Which is how much kilobytes? 2 to the power 4 is how much? Which is 16 kilobytes, I think, na? So each segment will be of 16 kilobytes. So bound is, I think, the size maximum. This maximum segment size is probably this. So bounds is actually referring that to be the size, the limits of each segment. So whether this physical address is crossing beyond the limits or not, we can check from the bound. So this 240 is less than 6FF. So it is well within the limit of the segment number 0. So it is not, it will not be an invalid address, it will be a valid address. But what will be the physical address? So physical address will be what? You have to add the base value, the base register value to the offset. So offset is what? Offset is 240 only. And if you add to the base, so it will be basically two thing plus again. In hexadecimal, if you have to write, the offset is again 240 only. So it will give you, in hexadecimal, it will give you 2240. Isn't it? Does it make sense, or has anybody doubt here? Everyone understand this? Can you do for the second virtual address? What will be the physical address? So here we are not giving any segment a particular connotation, whether it is a heap or stack. So we are not worried about whether it is going in the forward direction or backward direction or whatever. So that is the advantage. If you don't relate to any logical segment, we can assume we can have a fixed way of address translation for each segment. So what will be this address, which is referring to which segment? This one is referring to which segment? Anybody? So four will be basically 0 0, no, 0 1 0 0. So the top two bits represent the segment number. So it is referring to segment number 1. And what is the offset within that? The offset is 108 in hexadecimal. And that offset is less than the bounds. So it is a valid one. And how do we get the physical address? Physical address will be what? 0x0108. Yeah. So the base is 000. If you add 108, physical address will be, in hexadecimal, it will be 0108. Correct. So what about the last one? ए रिप्रेजेंट्स व्हाट? ए इज 10 ना, सो 10, हाउ डू यू रिप्रेजेंट 10 इन हेक्साडेसिमल इन बाइनरी? So 2, 4, 8. So 8010. So this represents, I think, 10. Isn't it? Or no? So it represents to be segment number 2. It is referring to segment number 2. And what is the offset within that? It is 65C. So 65C, it is well within the bounds. Yeah, it is within the bounds of the segment. It will be more. Chandralik 2. So it is within segment 2. Achha, it will be more, sorry, it is not 65C because there is 10 also. So your offset will be, what will be the offset value then? So I think the offset is beyond the bounds. Something's happening. So I think the offset value of this is more than this one. You can see that because here we have after 3 we have 10 more. So 65C is there, and then we have 10 also additional to that. So this address will be much more than this address. So in this case, that means this address is not a valid address because it is beyond the bounds of the current segment. So there won't be any physical address to this. Physical address will be an invalid address. It will not be, hardware will raise an exception to this. So there won't be a actual physical address for this. So I hope this numerical would have helped you to do some practice problem on address translation for different segments. Anyone has any doubt? So what are the disadvantages of this? So advantages we already talked about, but there are disadvantages still of this mechanism. What are they? So we have little more flexibility here, and we are avoiding internal fragmentation. In the sense, we are avoiding wastage of free space inside the virtual address or within each segment. If there are more segments, we need more registers to store base and bound for each segment. Yeah, that is, we'll have some overhead in the sense we'll need to store more information. But that overhead is not such a big problem because that much we can manage in hardware easily. That is not a main disadvantage here. The main disadvantage is something we have already talked about. It's called external fragmentation. Continuous virtual memory still has to be continuous in one segment in actual memory. Okay. Yeah, so he's saying that each segment still has to be contiguous. Yeah, that is one disadvantage which is going to be a problem here, because each segment itself can be a big size and it needs to be allocated one contiguous space into a in your physical address, and that is what will cause this external fragmentation. We'll talk about that. Usually saying fixing size of each segment. Size of each segment is not fixed here, because as we said, we have the bound to help us change the size of each segment. So size of each segment is variable. You can actually change the size of each segment. Yeah, the max limit is probably fixed. Once we divide, the max limit of where each segment can grow is fixed. But again, as I said, using the fine grade segmentation, you can use more than one segment to represent a particular logical segment. So you can use more than one segment for your heap and so on. So max size for each segment is fixed. Yeah, I accept that point. But as I said, you can if you want to still grow beyond that, you can use other segment also for that purpose. So that is not so much more change address stored in base and bound every time change in size. Yeah, but that update is also quick. It's just one update that has to happen. These are not really bottleneck problem. The main problem I think which come close to, which is basically say external fragmentation, the problem that each segment still needs a contiguous memory space. So when you are allocating and deallocating space from your free space, from your total free space, you will end up basically leaving little holes of free space in physical memory that will cause difficulty in allocating memory to new segments. To new segments or even new processes. So the idea is segment. So basic idea is simple. I'm just going to show it through a simple virtual address space. So once you have allocated spaces to different segments, let us say you have some reserved memories for OS, and then let us say you have given this space to, let us say, P1 or maybe segment 1. I'll, instead of calling P1 now, let us say segment 1, and then there is a free space, let us say, here, and then you have given this to segment 2 of process P1. So we can have, so multiple processes are also running. So this is segment 1 of P1, segment 2 of P2, and maybe another free space here, and then say segment 3 of, sorry, P1 only. Let's just consider there is only one process right now, and you have another free space here, and let us say each free space is of 10 KB 10 KB. And now let us say another process P2 wants to run, a request come, any allocation request comes for allocating, let us say, 15 KB. Could be just for one segment. So although now you have total free space, total free space is much more than what is the request that has come. But those free spaces are now fragmented. Your memory is now fragmented, and each, there are little spaces of little holes of free spaces distributed throughout your memory. So if a single request comes for allocating a 15K segment, you don't have that much sufficient memory available, because you need that contiguous memory for that entire segment at one place, and that space is not available. So that will cause difficulty. So these small little holes, basically, they cause difficulty in allocating memory to new segments or new processes. So what can be done? Is it an impossible problem to be solved? No, it can be. One simple mechanism is to do compaction that we have talked earlier, or defragmentation. Sometimes we call it defragmentation. So once in a while, OS will stop all the processes and will decide to basically rearrange its free space. So it probably it may decide all the used space to come at one location, S1, S2, S3 of process P1. And then the entire free space will come in together, it will become free. So now it can be, now it should be able to satisfy new request, because now you have chunked them into a contiguous location, all the free space, so it can manage. So this compaction can temporarily handle this external fragmentation problem. But what we said, this compaction process is expensive, because you have to stop everything and then shift copy the entire address space, so which is a memory intensive operation, and then restart the process and so on. So, or resume the process, it is going to be an expensive operation. But another problem with this compaction is that now once you have compacted all the space, all the segments at one location, it has an adverse effect or side effect of not being able to, if one of the segments wants to grow in size, so one of the existing segments, let us say now it wants to, if one of the existing segment was a heap, let us say, and it wanted to allocate more memory. So now allocating more memory will become a bit difficult. Earlier there was some free space nearby the allocated space. So growing this, allocating new little more memory, let us say 2 byte more memory here, would not be difficult for the OS. But here now for S2, let us say allocating 2 more bytes will be difficult. Then it has to again rearrange the space to make it available that. So that again causes a problem. So this free space management becomes very, very problematic. In fact, for any, this is a general problem we'll see later on for disk management also. And for any variable sized allocation, whenever we are doing a variable sized allocation of either memory or disk, this is a common point of memory or disk, then the free space management becomes little cumbersome, and often it leads to this problem of external fragmentation. So you can try to use some smart strategies of free space management to take care of these things, to try to minimize these things. So that is our next topic, basically. So that is the next chapter in the book, but I'm not going to discuss that chapter in detail, because normally we do it in labs, but at least the theory part you need to understand. So some theory part I'll just discuss about the free space management. Saying buddy heap and Fibonacci heap. Yeah, so those are like some allocation strategies that we are going to discuss, not in detail. So we need to do some free space management techniques. As I said earlier, there are two types of management happening, one at the OS level and one within the virtual address space itself. So each process at user level also, there is a memory management happening, which is happening in use at the programming language level. So the C programming routines will be managing that. The malloc routine and all those routines will be doing that. And there is another free space management which is happening at the OS level. And both have to do something similar. this free space management in the context of this variable sized allocation, whenever we have to do a variable size allocation, then free space management becomes tricky. We'll see later on, we can avoid this problem very much easily by going for a fixed size allocation. And then in that case, the free space management becomes easy. But until then, let us just discuss what can be done for a variable size allocation. So the idea is we want to do variable size allocation, but at the same time, we want to minimize the problem of fragmentation and overheads. So whatever overheads we need to do, we have to try to have minimal. We can have to do it in an efficient manner so that it does not take a lot of time to do that management. So some simple example here, let us say we have a free space. Let us represent a free space of 30 bytes here. So let us say we have 30 byte memory. And let us say you have 10 bytes free in the beginning. Then you have used up 10 bytes in the next, and then there is another 10 bytes free here. So as I said earlier, that the library or the OS will have to maintain some kind of a free list, some kind of a data structure. Normally we can use a simple linked list itself. So it keeps track of what are the free chunks of memory in our memory space. So here we have two free chunks of memory, so there can be two nodes. So we can have one node which says the starting address is 0 and its length is 10. And then the next node, the next free space is at address 20 and its length is also 10, and then the last is null. So currently we have two free chunks which are represented by two nodes here. The first node which stores the address and length, minimally this. There are other things, metadata also, but just a simple representation here. And then there is another node which says this free space is at the address 20 and its length is of 10. So to maintain this free list, there are some common mechanisms which are implemented. So one common mechanism is splitting. So the library should be able to split this free space. So splitting is basically splitting a free chunk of memory that can satisfy. So if a request, whenever a request for allocating a memory comes, so we find a free chunk which has memory at least that much what is being requested, and then you can split that memory chunk to satisfy that request and return the remaining chunk into the free space list. So let us say one of this existing allocated space wanted to grow more. So it wanted to allocate, let us say you wanted to allocate extra 1 byte or 2 bytes, let us say. You wanted to allocate 2 bytes of memory more in the existing one, the existing segment or the process which was using this 10 bytes in the middle. It wanted to allocate 2 more bytes. So basically the OS or the library will basically search this free list and find the appropriate chunk from where this 2 byte can be allocated. So probably in this case, it is going to extend here. So it will find that this chunk is appropriate to give the 2 bytes. So this chunk will be splitted. So our free space will become something like this. So we'll have now 2 more bytes will be given. So we have 20 and, sorry. Okay, 20 and then 22 and then 30. So initially it was taking 10 bytes, and now two more bytes are given, and this remaining one is returned to the free pool. So free list will be modified appropriately. So we'll have our head pointer. The first node will remain as it is. So first node remains as it is. Length. Our second node will be splitted. So the 2 bytes will be given to the allocated space, and your remaining in the remaining thing you will have basically the next address will be modified. It will start from 22, and length will be how much? 8. So that will be updated. So this is called splitting. And similarly, when something is freed, then that chunk has to be again returned back to the free list. And either it can be added as a separate node, or sometimes if it is near to a space, then it can be coalesced. Everything can be coalesced into one single chunk. So let us say this 10 kilobytes which was being used, it was, let us say, freed. So in that case, what will happen? Coalescing will happen. So in coalescing, what is happening is when a chunk is freed, then you basically decide to merge it. And if it is adjacent to one of the free chunks, then you decide to merge it with the so when a chunk is freed, then you look at the adjacent locations and the addresses of the free chunks, and if there is any existing nearby free chunks, then you merge it with that. You merge it with existing nearby free chunks, free spaces. So taking our example, let us say you, in the previous example, you were using 10 bytes here, and that's let us say the program basically released that 10 bytes. So we are not considering this, we are considering the original scenario here. This was the original scenario. Let us say that 10 bytes was made free. So either if you don't want to think anything, you just insert you create a new node for this 10 bytes and insert it either in the beginning of the list or at the end of the list. So if you are maintaining the head pointer, the easiest is to insert at the beginning of the list itself. So easiest is to insert at the beginning of the list itself. So you can basically say now we have a new node with head address 10 and length 10. Or let's say you were, instead of that, you were basically, let's say you were doing, let us say you were just using the entire thing here. So now this entire 12 bytes was freed. So this address will be 12 bytes. And then you have the other nodes as it is. Maybe I can copy that from here. Just copy it. I don't know whether it took more time than I would have drawn myself. So that is one way to modify the list, or the library can go over these nodes and see that these addresses are adjacent addresses basically. So it can just simplify this list and just merge into one single node, saying that address from 0 and length is 30. So this is called coalescing. When you are merging the adjacent chunks of nearby addresses, this is called merging. So I think we are little up with time. So we just wanted to discuss. So these are mechanism to manage your free list, and then there are strategies also. I'll just discuss little bit how to allocate these free spaces. So which chunk to choose, which chunk to select while a request to satisfy a particular request. So common strategies like there is a best fit strategy. So best fit strategy says that you allocate the free chunk that is closest to the that is closest in size to the request that has come. So for example, if you had 10, 30 and 20 of bytes of memory, and let us say a request came to allocate 15 bytes. So what will best fit, which one of the chunk the best fit will choose? So it should be greater than, so 10 cannot satisfy that, 30 can satisfy and 20 can satisfy this request. So but which one is the closest in size? So 20 is the closest size. So what it will do, it will take 15 bytes from that chunk and return the remaining in the free list. So 5 will be left and 15 will be allocated to the process. So your updated list will become like this. So the advantage of this best fit algorithm is it basically tries to reduce the wasted space. So it tries to reduce this space that is wasted, because now in some sense 5 is wasted, because 5 may not be satisfied by any other request. Or so instead of giving it from 30, it tries to give it from 20 so that the remaining space that is left is minimized. But the problem with this, you have to exhaustively search the list. So you have to search the entire list, find which one of them are can satisfy the request, and then among them find which one is the best fitting. So that is the thing. The other extreme of this strategy is called worst fit algorithm. In the worst fit, basically you allocate free chunk that is farthest in size. So in the previous example itself, instead of selecting 20, you will select the 30. So in this case, it will basically find that 30 is the largest one. So it will allocate memory from the 30, and 15 will remain. 15 will come back to the free space. Oh, sorry, this will remain 20. So this also has a valid rationale that by choosing the chunk which is farthest in size, you will leave a bigger chunk in the free space rather than leaving smaller chunks in the free space which cannot satisfy future request. You try to leave bigger chunks in your free space that can potentially satisfy the future request. So it tries to basically leave big chunks free instead of smaller holes or small chunks instead of small ones. So big chunks will be more useful than small chunks. But again, this also have to you still have to do the search operation. You have to basically do the full search. Although you can optimize the search operation instead of using a linear list, you can use a binary search tree or whatever to try to improve your search operation. Then I think I'll stop here. So then there is a first fit, which basically says instead of doing entire searching, you basically find the first one which fits. Which can satisfy the request and give it from there itself. So there you don't have to do exhaustive search, so it is fast. But the problem is that you will end up wasting creating small chunks in the beginning of the list. And to avoid that, there is a next fit algorithm which basically says you keep track where you started till the last point, and now from there now look forward. So instead of always looking from the beginning of the list, wherever you looked at last, you search from there onwards the further ones. So and then as soon as you get a chunk which can satisfy the request, give from there. So each has its own. There is no optimal strategy. You can use different strategies, but actually, ideally, there are advanced strategies which are used, not these simple strategies. For example, there is a buddy allocator algorithm. Somebody pointed it out in the chat window. So I don't have time today, but it's a very simple algorithm. You can read from the book. Basically, it divides your, let us say, if you have 64 KB of free space, it divides into power of 2 space, so 32 gets divided into 16 and 16, and then 16 gets divided into, let us say, 8 KB. So if your request was for 8 KB, then it will give one of these chunks. So the idea is that when it is released, you can merge with its buddy neighbor to create a bigger chunk. So and searching is very easy in this kind of a tree structure. Searching of its neighbor and merging and becomes more easy. So you can study about in the book. It's a very simple thing that will be your homework exercise to study about this buddy allocation. So I'll stop here.